Good morning, Vintage Church, and welcome to our online service. Whether you're joining us on YouTube or Facebook, we're just so excited that you are here with us this morning, and we hope that you are ministered to through the Word. And wherever you are, whether you're in your family room or you're in the car or on out for a jog, that you would sing along and worship and seek the Lord with us this morning. If you're newer to Vintage Church, I want to encourage you to visit us at our website. That's vintage1948.com. There you can learn more about us. And if you want to be followed up with, or maybe you have a prayer request or some need for counseling, or just you want to talk and ask more questions about this replant and our mission, I want to encourage you to fill out a connect form. You can do that at vintage1948.com/connect. And then also on our website, you can give. If you want to support us and the mission that God has given us to make disciples that are rooted in Christ, cultivated in gospel community, and fruitful in everyday life, you can do that. And if you go to vintage1948.com/give, there you can find information, our online giving portal, and also information on how you can give via text, and also our address if you choose to mail in your check. And please make out your check to Lodi Community Church. We're on the home stretch of getting all the paperwork done so that you can make those checks out to Vintage Church as we're in the middle of this transition and this replant. But really, exciting things are coming this month. We have a few movie nights in the parking lot that we're planning for. This week we're giving 50 appreciation gifts to the teachers at Lakewood. And also, as it's getting colder and fall is upon us, we're planning on gathering some warm clothes and toiletries that we can help serve the poor and disadvantaged in our community. And I know that we've done this in the past, and so we want to do that again, and we want to get the word out, especially since today we're talking about giving to the poor. And so whether it's toothpaste, lotion, shampoo, soap, hats like beanies, warm gloves, socks, sweatshirts with hoods, and the zippers are preferred, and even sleeping bags. And so whether you're at the Dollar Tree or Walmart or wherever you shop, or even if it's on Amazon and you pick some of those up, we can coordinate a time for you to drop it off at the office. And I would love for you to partner with us in loving and serving the poor and disadvantaged in our community as we gather these much needed materials and seek to bless them. We'll be distributing them around Thanksgiving, and so we'll give more information, more details, and more updates as we get closer to that date. But just wanted to put the word out there and invite you to start thinking through this so that we can be generous as a church. And then lastly, I just want to say thank you for everyone that prayed for us and supported us over the last 2 weeks. I know a few things have been put on the back burner, but really it's just been overwhelming for our family as we have been wrestling with the loss of someone so loved, who was like a son to us. And yesterday we had the funeral and the graveside service and the reception, and I just want to say thank you so much to Darlene and Barbara, who helped set up and decorate. And then Lee and Jackie were rock stars. Lee power washed the church, the courtyard, and the patio. And Jackie was a rock star in the kitchen, helping clean up, set up, manage the kitchen. She was awesome. So thank you. And then just thank you for everyone who prayed and supported us, sent us cards. We just felt so loved and appreciated. And so just thank you, thank you, thank you. And Tara is resting. It's been just a brutal last couple of days, and our family is doing well, but we are emotional and tired. And so just continue to pray for our family as we're entering into the fall and wanting to continue to reach our neighborhood with the gospel. And so with that, I'm going to pray. And we are continuing today in our series in the Sermon on the Mount, and we're starting a new section, and we talk about how to practice our righteousness. And so let's just seek the Lord. I don't know where you're at this morning. You could be emotionally exhausted as well. I know there are so many that are wrestling with sickness and relational issues, isolation, depression, anxiety. And this is just a time for us to seek the Lord. This is us. This is our opportunity to pray, to cast our anxieties on the Lord, knowing that He cares for us. I have felt His grace throughout this process of grieving and mourning, and I am so thankful that the Lord sees us and that He is more than able to help us in our time of need. So let's pray this morning. Father, we just come and we say we love You and we need You this morning. You know our individual circumstances. You know the areas in our life that need Your grace more than others. Lord, for those that are dealing with anxiety or confusion and stress, I just pray that You would meet them in this time. As they lift their eyes to heaven, as they begin to sing praises to You, would they feel Your presence and would You fill their hearts with love? Father, we need You to meet us in this time, to open our hearts to who You are, to open our eyes to see the wonderful things in Your Word, so that we would be shaped and molded and formed more and more into Your image. Jesus, we want to be like You. We know that in our world and in our country, there are divisions and confusion and chaos. And so we pray for our country. We pray for our elected leaders. God, we pray for the churches that they would rise up. We pray for truth. We pray that, God, we would be the people of God, and that ultimately, Lord, You would continue to teach us how to pray. Let Your kingdom come and let Your will be done on earth for us in Lodi as it is in heaven, Lord. We need You, King Jesus, so take Your throne. It's in Your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. And so with that, we'll have two songs. The words will be on the screen. We invite you to sing, to lift up your hands, to worship God, to seek Him, to make His praise glorious. And then we ask that you would join us, open your Bibles as we continue our series in the Sermon on the Mount. Thank you.
And I hear the Savior say, and thy strength indeed is small, child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. As Jesus paid it all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as I stand in Him complete. soul to save. My lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all, all to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Yes, He did.
Sin was great, Your love was greater. Good morning. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6. We're continuing in the series on the Sermon on the Mount, and we just wrapped up the first section where Jesus is talking about our need for transformation at a heart level. Remember, in verse 20 of chapter 5, Jesus says that if our righteousness does not surpass and exceed that of the Pharisees, then we will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now, that would have come as quite the shock to those in the crowd listening to Jesus in this amazing Sermon on the Mount. For the religious elite of the day were the Pharisees. They were the ones giving to the poor, and they were the ones fasting, and they were the ones who were seen as the leaders of the religious movement of Judaism. And so for Jesus to say to those listening, those ragtag group of people that were filling the countryside, to hear Jesus speak as one with authority, this would have blew their mind. And yet, remember, in Jesus' words, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. In other words, Jesus is after something deeper than just surface level, what he'll call in this text, hypocritical religion. Religion that is mere behavior modification. It's religious acts and service that is done for the approval and the applause of men rather than God. And Jesus is now entering into his second section in the Sermon on the Mount, where he's talking about practicing righteousness. And so if you have your Bibles and you've turned there with me, we're going to be reading this morning in verses 1 through 4 of Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. And so if you would, and if you are able, please stand for the reading of God's Word. We do this to honor God's Word. It's a way of setting it apart and saying that Scripture is important, that we sit under the Word of God. We want it to instruct us, to shape us, and to form us more and more into the image of Christ. And so we ask, even as we read, that the Holy Spirit would open the eyes of our hearts, that we would have a greater understanding and a greater revelation of Jesus, to whom all of Scripture points. And so, reading from verse 1, it says this: Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father, who sees in secret, will reward you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your Word. Thank you so much for the living Word, the incarnate Word, Jesus, who came to reveal you to us. And so as we not only get to hear him in this text, but now through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can have you revealed to us in a powerful way. And so, Lord, we just ask that you would be here. Be with us. Be with those that are watching online. We want to learn from you. We want to know your way. We want to be able to practice righteousness in a way that honors you and develops us spiritually, so that we would grow more and more like you. And we say all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I once read a quote by Leonard Ravenhill that said, "The secret of praying is praying in secret." And as we begin to unpack the next 18 verses over the next 3 weeks, maybe more, because we might spend a little bit more time in the Lord's Prayer, which is in this section of Scripture, what we're going to see is that what we do in secret matters most. That God pays attention to what we do in the secret. Men may look on the outward. Remember David's brothers in the Old Testament. They looked on the outward and they misjudged the heart of David. And it took Samuel to come in and say what God sees, and that God sees us at the heart level. He sees in secret. And this isn't good news for the religious Pharisees of Jesus' day, because they love the approval, they love the applause, they love the praise, they love the glory of men rather than God. And Jesus is telling us three things that we need to pay attention to in these verses. Number one, Jesus assumes that righteousness must be practice. And number two, there is a danger in practicing righteousness. And number three, practicing righteousness in secret is rewarded. So let's take that first one and unpack it together this morning. Number one, Jesus assumes that righteousness must be practiced. Look at verse 1 with me again. It says, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people." So Jesus assumes that the life that we live in Christ, to be a disciple of the kingdom, an apprentice in the kingdom, requires us to act. It requires us to practice our righteousness. Some would get hung up on that word righteousness, and they would consider Paul's writings that we are made righteous by faith, and that is true. But when Jesus is talking about righteousness here, he's talking about our acts. He's talking about what we do to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world, so that people may see our acts of righteousness and glorify our Father who is in heaven. And so in verse 2, it says, "Thus," he gives us three examples in the next 18 verses about these practices of righteousness. Now, these were the three most common acts of righteousness for the Jew in ancient Palestine: almsgiving, prayer, and fasting. There are much more spiritual disciplines and rhythms of grace that we may discuss over the next few weeks, but these are the three that Jesus highlights. Now, pay attention to verse 2. It says, "Thus, when you give to the needy," and later it will say, "when you pray," and it will even say, "when you fast." And so the first thing that we must pay attention to is that Jesus assumes when you fast, when you pray, when you give. Jesus assumes that the disciple, that the apprentice in the kingdom, will be practicing righteousness. And for many of us, and especially in the West, I fear that many of us are watching evangelicalism, the church in the West, begin to be shaken and begin to crumble. And we are seeing leaders that we had high respect for fall. Why? Why is this happening around us? I believe that it's a rebuke of our lack of practicing righteousness in the secret place. In other words, this trend of celebrity pastors, of doing ministry for the applause and the praise of men, is weakening our witness in the world. Jesus assumes that righteousness must be practiced. So there must be service. There must be ministry. There must be giving. There must be fasting. There must be prayer in order for the disciple to become more and more like Jesus, to become more and more like the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven must be cultivated. It must be developed. It must grow. And the only way for us to do that is to practice righteousness. And so I just want to take this moment and ask you to do an inventory in your own life. Do you practice righteousness. Now, when it comes to practice, if you play sports, you know that practice is the place where you sometimes get it right and you sometimes get it wrong. That it isn't always perfect, but it's practice. And so you may have had a history of sometimes giving and sometimes not giving. And especially with the area of prayers we'll talk about in the coming weeks. I don't know about you, but I have had many times where I wanted to get up and pray and tried to pray and just failed to pray because I'm practicing righteousness. But I get back up and I keep learning and I keep practicing because I want to grow in the kingdom. I want to be developed in the values and the culture of the kingdom. And so Jesus says very clearly that righteousness must be practiced. He assumes it. And so if there's somewhere in your life as a Christian, as a disciple of Jesus, where you think that attending church is sufficient, Jesus says, no, that's not correct. You must practice righteousness. And it will be a daily grind. I mean, I played baseball in high school, and I got injured my junior year, but practice, even at a high school level, was daily. Yes, we may have had the weekends off, but I usually played on Saturdays, and Sunday I would probably throw the ball around even then. And so practice is something that you do daily. It takes time and effort. It costs you. There's a grind to it where I have to get up and go practice and practice and practice. And so Jesus talks about these activities, these quote-unquote spiritual disciplines, as things that we practice. And so again, do you practice these things? Do you practice the things of the kingdom? Do you practice giving, fasting? Do you practice prayer? These are things that we must practice because Jesus assumes that righteousness must be practiced. So we cannot expect to grow as a disciple of Jesus and not practice. The same would be true if I wanted to be the best baseball player I could be and never practice. That just doesn't make sense. If you want to be a highly skilled, highly successful athlete or dancer or musician, you must practice and practice and practice. And so Jesus comes along and says, if you want to grow in the kingdom, if you want to be a disciple of mine, then you must practice. Practice these things. But number two, there is a danger in practicing righteousness. And Jesus says it right out of the gate in verse 1. Beware. Beware. Pay attention. Beware. There's a trip hazard. There's a rock that you need to avoid. There is an obstacle. There is something that will get in the way of you practicing righteousness. It's not like practicing a sport or practicing on an instrument or practicing another craft. There is something peculiar about practicing righteousness, so beware. What is this danger? What is this trip hazard? Beware of practicing your righteousness, Jesus says, before other people, in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Number two, there is a danger in practicing our righteousness before others. Why? Because the human heart, our flesh, what the Apostle Paul would say, that fallen part of who we are. For if you are a Christian, yes, you have been made into a new creation in Christ Jesus. You have been made alive in Christ. And yet we have still the flesh, the old man. And we are constantly being renewed. We are constantly being transformed as we no longer conform to the pattern of this world, but we're transformed by the renewing of our mind. And that takes practice. But that old man, the flesh, craves glory. It craves the applause of men. It craves attention. It craves approval from others. Practicing righteousness does lead towards being the salt of the earth. It does lead toward us being the light of the world. By very nature, righteousness is to be seen. And so for some, they may see, how is this consistent with what Jesus said in the first part of the Sermon on the Mount when he said, do these things so that you will be seen. But here's the catch. Why did Jesus say they would be seen? What was the motive? What was the result? Well, let's look again in Matthew chapter 5, verse 15. He's talking about us being the light of the world, the salt of the earth. And in verse 16, it says, in the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So the key here is glory. The key here is applause. The key here is approval and praise. Who gets it? That's the big question this morning. What is your motive? Are you seeking glory? Are you seeking applause? Do you want to be seen as you practice your righteousness? It reminds me of a funny story. I was 13, and we were out camping somewhere, and there were two girls, they were twins, that seemed to notice me, and I noticed them, and being a teenager, I was like, well, what can I do to get more of their attention? And so I thought, you know what, this is what I would do. I will wear a tank top, and I will chop wood, and I will impress them with my biceps. I know what you're thinking, but just, it's an illustration here. As I was chopping the wood, you could see my mom and stepdad laughing because they knew exactly why I was performing this quote-unquote act of service and righteousness for the camp, right? That's the, I'll go chop some wood. Oh, you need some more wood for the fire? You need some more wood for the campfire tonight? I know what I'll do. I'll go chop wood because look how good I am. But really, what I wanted was attention. Really, what I wanted was to be noticed by those girls next door. And oftentimes, when we're practicing our righteousness, just in and of itself, the act is good. We're giving to the poor. We're going on missions trips. We're preaching sermons. We're setting up for events. We're praying at our corporate prayer meetings. We're giving. We're fasting. We are posting things on social media. And all of it in and of itself may be good. But what Jesus is getting at here is, what is the motive behind it? What is the motive behind it? There is a danger in practicing righteousness, because righteousness leads to glory. Righteousness is a light that burns bright in our world. And Jesus says, yes, you are the salt of the earth. Yes, you are the light of the world. But the goal here is always that people may see your righteous acts that are light, that is salt, and glorify your Father in heaven. The glory belongs to him. But when you rob God of that glory and you seek glory for yourself, there's a danger. There's a trap, and it's not good. For Jesus says, then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. The reward, Jesus says, is the praise of men. And as we all know, the praise and the approval and the applause of men is fleeting. It's empty. It's vain. It can vanish like that. You see, all of us, our hearts, we crave to be accepted. We want to hear those words, well done, my good and faithful servant. That phrase, well done, we all love it, don't we? We all love to having done something, good job, well done. Even after preaching a sermon, I'm looking for that. And that's my flesh. It's wanting to be approved. It's wanting to be accepted. It's wanting to know, good job. Now, there's a place for constructive feedback and the like, but you have to continually ask yourself. And Jesus is saying, listen, the heart craves glory. The flesh craves glory. So beware. There is a danger in practicing righteousness. And if you practice righteousness just to be seen by others, just to be noticed and get attention, then you have your reward. And that's a dangerous, dangerous game. Because as disciples in the kingdom, apprentices in the kingdom, we want to be like Jesus. And this reward, some may have questions about what this reward is. And one commentary that I appreciated said this, that this reward, it's both in time and in eternity, both in character and in felicity. In other words, this reward is complex. It's not a quid pro quo. It's not a one thing for another. This is a blessing that God gives. It could be in heaven, right? We can store up in our treasure in heaven. And so that is true, but there is also earthly blessings that we may receive. And it's ultimately up to God to dispense those blessings as he pleases in his own providence according to his will. And we trust him. We don't do it to get the reward. We do it to bless our Father. We do it to love our Father. We do it to glorify the God who saved us by grace. This is our motive. So the question this morning is, when you practice righteousness, when you give, when you fast, when you pray, when you take a Sabbath, when you practice silence and solitude, when you study, when you serve, who is receiving the glory? That's the main question before us this morning. Who is receiving the glory? Jesus said in John chapter 5, verse 39, I do not receive glory from people. Think about that. I do not receive glory from people. Jesus was not looking for applause. He was not looking for human acceptance. He longed and lived for the pleasure of God. He lived before the audience, an audience of one. And the problem with the religious of Jesus' day and the problem with the religious of our day is that they live for the audience of many. They are living for the audience that gathers around when they practice their righteousness. And yet Jesus says, listen, the key to spiritual growth, the key to true spiritual formation is practicing righteousness in secret. When nobody's looking, when nobody notices, do you practice righteousness? And the same could be said for the athlete. The same could be said for the musician. Knowing some athletes and musicians, the best practice in secret. Nobody knows the hours and hours and hours, the devotion and dedication to the craft to become the best version of themselves in terms of athletics or music or any other craft. It could be business. It could be leadership. It oftentimes goes to what is done in secret when nobody is looking. And the same applies for kingdom living. Because number three, practicing righteousness in secret is rewarded. Jesus is clear about this. Then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. And in verse 4, talking about giving to the poor, he says, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. There is an approval trap when it comes to practicing righteousness. And in Galatians chapter 1, verse 10, Paul addresses this approval trap, this seeking glory from others. He says, "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ." In other words, trying to please man and servant of Christ, they're mutually exclusive. They cannot coexist. And this is what Jesus is calling out in chapter 6. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. There is danger in practicing righteousness. There is an approval trap. And you may start out with a sincere motive. You may start out with a desire to glorify God and to please God in heaven. And somewhere along the way, men take notice of you. They say, "You're doing a great job. You are a gifted speaker. You have a talent for this. You're gifted. You give generously. Wow, that is amazing. We couldn't do this without you." And that praise that could be a form of encouragement, that you reflect it back to the glory of God, instead it begins to seep into your heart and your flesh begins to crave it, and you begin to say, "Yes, I am something. I am." And that glory is the death of the reward of the Father in heaven. Now, in man's eyes and in our market-driven celebrity pastor Christian culture, sometimes that may be a successful ministry in the eyes of the world. But again, if that's all the reward that you have, and it's done for a motive to gain applause and gain approval, to gain earthly treasure, then Jesus says that is your reward. And that's a scary reality for me, for you, for those that love Jesus. If we do it with the wrong motives, to gain attention and applause, to gain glory, that is our reward. In John 5:39, Jesus says, "They received glory from one another and do not seek the glory that comes from the only God." You see, the Pharisees love to receive glory from one another. And in my many years in ministry, I've seen this play itself out, where those who love applause and love glory, they only hang around people that give glory and applause to them. And they'll reciprocate it and vice versa. But they create these little pockets of Pharisees, of religious elite who, "Oh, you're doing such a great job." And, "Oh, you're doing..." And then it just continues to ramp up, and it's just a glory fest amongst themselves. And Jesus says to the Pharisees, they received glory from one another, but they do not seek the glory that comes from the only God. Remember, the question before us this morning as we begin to talk about practicing righteousness over these next few weeks is, who is receiving the glory? God will not be robbed of his glory. You see, the Pharisees lived for an audience of many. And Jesus is inviting his disciples to live for the audience of one. This was a common theme, because not only in John chapter 5, John chapter 12, verse 43 says, "They loved the glory that comes from man more than the glory that comes from God." What do you love more? Do you love the glory from man? Do you love that acceptance? Do you love that approval? Do you love the applause more than the glory that comes from God? Because that glory may be delayed. It's not instant. It doesn't feed your flesh. It may come in heaven. it may come to you as a reward in at the return of Christ as King of the earth. We may be storing up treasure in heaven that we will not see, that nobody will see. You'll never get a round of applause. You'll never receive any glory, no praise, no honor, no appreciation. The only one who sees will be God in heaven in the secret place. And God says, is that enough for you? Is that enough for you? Do you love glory that comes from man, or do you love glory that comes from God and God alone? And I think this is sadly an indictment on our Western Christianity. I think we're so weak and shaken easily because our private life of devotion and spirituality, the secret place, is anemic. It's weak. And I know for me, it's much easier at times to pray in a public setting rather than to pour out my heart before God. Why? I was praying about this and preparing for this sermon, and the verse Hebrews 11:6 kept on coming up. And, you know, it's a familiar verse, but I saw it in a different light as I was thinking about the Sermon on the Mount and what Jesus is saying. I want to read it to you this morning. In Hebrews 11, this, what some have called the Hall of Faith, this is a bunch of heroes of the faith who practice righteousness. And it says that all of these men and women practice their righteousness because of faith. And think about this with me. In verse 6, it says, without faith, it's impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Now, this is going to get revealing, because I believe when it talks to us about the secret place, whether it's prayer, giving, or fasting, the true motives of our heart will be exposed. Because when I pray, and it's just me in my closet, it's just me in my car, it's just me, and nobody is paying attention, nobody is looking, do I believe that God sees? Do I believe that God hears? Do I believe that he is faithful? Do I believe Hebrews 11:6, that without faith, it's impossible to please him? For whoever would draw near to God, whoever would draw near to God in the secret place, they must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. In other words, if I am in the secret place and I am seeking God, if I am praying to God, if I am fasting and no one notices and nobody sees, if I'm giving to the poor and I never get credit for it, but do I believe that by doing these things, God sees, he sees in the secret, and that he will reward me in this life or in the next? Without faith, it's impossible to please him. We must believe that he exists. And for some of us, rubber meets the road. When we go to the secret place, our faith is tested. But we can practice righteousness in the church. We can practice righteousness in nonprofits and on the mission field. We can practice at our gatherings and on our outreaches and in our ministries and our kids' ministries and the whole life of the church. We can practice our righteousness because everybody sees it. We get appreciated. We get encouraged. We get some reward. We get some honor. We get some applause, and we're good with that. But if nobody sees it and we're doing it just us and God, well, that's a whole other different story. And this is, to me, a challenge. This is to you a challenge. What do you do in the secret place? Just you and God. Do you obey? Do you pray? Do you give? Think about some of these examples. When you serve and you don't get a call from the pastor. When you give and you don't get a thank you letter. When you volunteer and you don't feel appreciated. When you preach a sermon and you don't get a great job. That one hurts. It stings. When you set up for an event and nobody knows or mentions your name. How do you respond? How do you feel? Are you grasping and seeking for applause? Are you looking for that acceptance, that glory? Are you craving it? That's your flesh, brother and sister. And Jesus is saying, beware. Jesus is saying, pay attention. There is a danger in practicing righteousness. But practicing righteousness in secret is rewarded in this life and in the next. So number one, yes, he assumes that we must be practicing righteousness, but he's giving us a warning. It's a warning, church. When you practice righteousness, beware. Beware of the approval trap. Beware of the hunger and the craving for the approval of man. At the heart of this, it is about glory. Are you seeking glory? Are you trying to gain glory for yourself? Or do you, has your heart been liberated by grace so that you can freely give all the glory to God and say, sola Deo gloria, glory to God alone. It's His. It belongs all to Him. Everything belongs to Him. He's the creator of heaven and earth. It all belongs to Him. Every breath that I breathe is bonus. Every breath is a gift. Gift of grace. I don't deserve anything. I've sinned against the God in heaven and on earth. And any grace, any life that I have, any gift, any blessing, it is all grace. So all glory belongs to Him. Church, that's our life. And that's what shines the brightest. That's what shines the brightest. Do we live for the audience of many, or do we live for the audience of one? Jesus wants us to be aware that there is a trap, that there is a danger in practicing righteousness. But he also wants us to know that it's in practicing righteousness in the secret place, because we believe in God, because of true faith, of simplistic faith, where we believe that God exists, so we draw near in the secret place. And we believe that God is a rewarder of those who earnestly seek Him in the secret place. It is that God sees, and it is that God is pleased with. It is that, church, that we need to get back to. We'll talk more about giving next week. But in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus says, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you. Most scholars think there were no trumpets. Sometimes there were feasts and trumpets would be playing. And it was at that time that the Pharisees, when everybody was looking, begin to go and give their gifts to the poor so that everyone would notice them. Some might think Jesus is just using hyperbole and metaphor here to make his point. But he says, don't be like the hypocrites, those who play the part. And this morning, are you playing the part? Are you playing the part? Because those who want applause, those who crave acceptance, those who want glory, those who want fame, they just play the part. There are many in church who just play the part. And Jesus says, beware those who practice righteousness, who play the part because they want glory. In the streets, that they may be praised by other. The word there is out of this Greek word doxa, where we get the word glory and honor. They want glory. They want honor. They want praise. They want applause. But he says, truly I say to you, they've received their reward. Their reward is the applause of men, the fleeting praise of men. That's it. That's their reward. But when you give to the needy. So Jesus here, you got to see this. He's saying them, the Pharisees out there, plural. Then he hones it down to you, singular, but when you. He's talking to you right now. He's talking to you, the disciple of Jesus, the apprentice in the kingdom. He's saying, but when you practice righteousness, beware that there is a danger in practicing righteousness before others. And here he pounds down the point, practice your righteousness in secret so you will be rewarded. Verse 3, but when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Church, this morning, let's trust Jesus in the path forward. Let's learn from him that he assumes that we will practice righteousness. But let's also heed his warning and beware that practicing righteousness in front of others, that there is an inherent danger in that, given our flesh's craving for glory. And then finally, let us learn over these next few weeks what it looks like to practice righteousness in the secret place so that we will be rewarded. Brothers and sisters, without faith, it's impossible to please God. We must believe that he exists, and he exists in the secret place when no one else is looking and it's just him and you. He exists, and he's a rewarder of those who earnestly seek him. So let us abide in the secret place. Let us practice righteousness in the secret place, and let's see what God will do, who has promised to reward us in this life and in the next. Let's pray. Father, I ask you even now to be with us in this secret place. Call us, call our hearts to that place where it's just you and us. And God, let us, through your Spirit, examine our hearts, examine our motives. And if there is any part of us that we crave the acceptance and the approval and the applause of men more than we love the glory of God, then may we repent even now. And may we seek you in the secret place. And we say these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As you go this morning, I want to send you out with a benediction out of Psalm 115. It's one verse, it's one line, but it's something that we need to take to heart as we seek to glorify God. And it says this in verse 1, Psalm 115, verse 1, "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory, for the sake of your steadfast love and your faithfulness." Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory. Why? Because of his steadfast love and his faithfulness. So as you go this morning, would you remember his love? Would you remember his grace? And because of his grace, because all of it is grace, we would say, not to us, but to your name be the glory. Have a blessed week. We'll see you next weekend.